figure out how to make this. Who am I looking at? Look at you, look at you.
You want to look at me. You should see a screen with you and me surrounded by tinsel.
Yeah. Well, the camera's between the split. The notes are above, so now I'm looking at the notes, and now I'm looking at the show, so I should be looking at the show.
Yeah, you have rebuilt your studio, right?
It's in progress.
Not quite done?
I sent you a picture. It's kind of been the last 2 days of doing that, because on the other show, all the slides and whatever are all in Keynote. And I had this Mac Mini sitting here waiting to do something with. So I'm on the Mac stack side, and the Windows is over here still. So I'll back and forth until I get it all figured out.
Okay. My computer is beginning to bog down. I don't know why. This is your studio in progress. And now we need to... now we need to check and see if...
Yeah.
If we're doing, did I leave the audio on? Okay, yeah, I left the audio on.
This is over here still, so I'll back and forth until I get it all figured out.
The audio is working.
Okay. We're on.
We're on YouTube. I'll check Facebook real quick here.
Yeah, you're on the Facebook.
Okay. You're right on the ball. Okay, so I've got a couple of minutes to go. I've been in serious engineering mode. I'll show you what I've done.
Choo-choo engineering mode, or?
Yeah. Yeah, because trains are a big part of my life. Listeners who have been taking careful notes on the show, remember that I complained that here on the FT5 square pants talkie, that when I plugged in my FBI headset, it didn't stay in. It would plug in, but it would, as I had it down on my belt, it would pop out, and then there'd be nothing in my ear, nothing in the
wouldn't hear anything
FBI stealth thing, and I wouldn't know. You know, people would be talking, and I wouldn't know that I lost them. And I think somebody else made a note on a Facebook group that said there's a little rubber grommet that's in there that probably is part of what keeps this thing waterproof. But if you take that out, things will work. I'm going to turn my mic up and switch off the noise gate. So you hear a little bit more hiss in the background.
So you take the grommet off, and does it holds it in better?
I think you'll hear a satisfying click.
Yep.
Could you hear the satisfying click?
Yeah. I heard it twice. Yeah. Oh, it stays in there now?
Yeah, it stays in well. And I had it down on my belt, and everything was fine. So that was a bit of serious engineering. It took a pair of needle nose pliers and just pulled it out. And then this is an old Bluetooth speaker. It works great. It sounds great. The battery should have died long ago, but they did not. But it dropped. It was sitting up on a shower. It's waterproof. I use it in the shower. It was sitting up on the top of the shower rail, and it dropped and hit the floor. It's dropped dozens of times. And when it dropped, suddenly it kind of lost its bass response. Not enough that I could really tell and be really sure. But anyway, I opened it all up, and I found that there's two speakers in here. There seems to be a speaker here, but there's not. There's two speakers, and I found one of them had a retaining bracket, plastic retaining bracket that cracked, and the speaker was off, out of place just by a little bit, which indicates that, I mean, there's not a woofer in this thing, just two, about one and a half inch speakers. It indicated that the way they designed it is the box provided the resonance for the bass. Good design. And I got the speaker back mounted correctly. I couldn't fix the break. I tried with some Gorilla glue, but it wouldn't hold. But it's being held in on one side, and everything is fine. a big screwdriver work. No, not even any soldering involved. But that's two areas of engineering. And our guests are going to now try to get me to work on their repeaters. Or maybe I've convinced them that that's probably a bad idea.
Don't let him do it.
I'm looking at their pictures over on the Zoom screen, and they're not nodding their head either way. They should be going, no, he's never coming up to see the repeaters.
I'll take you up there.
don't let him touch anything.
Yeah, just to take pictures off the roof.
Yeah. A straight jacket.
So what's going on out in California? We got about a minute to kill here. Oh, I didn't put the countdown in. I didn't even set up the countdown.
It warmed up the last couple of days. Although we're supposed to have rain. I need to go get a tarp this afternoon to cover the foxhole in the front yard.
You dug a foxhole?
Well, it's really the cover of the septic tank that's dug up because I got to get it pumped out. But I've affectionately called it a foxhole because that's what it looks like.
Okay.
It ain't foxes in there.
No, there's no foxes.
You guys shut up.
I'm not hoping not to have to run from enemy fire and end up in there, but it's set up for it if I need it. Yeah.
Don't make me pull Zoom moderator rank here.
Okay.
We have two guests coming on the show. Just a minute. I don't even know what time it is. I'm sure my clock is not even close.
2 minutes of.
Okay.
How long are you... How long are you hoping to keep the intro to the pre-roll before we get to the main topic, Gary?
I need to tell people about the Netflix. That's all.
Yeah. Okay.
It's all there on the script.
I'll let you. I saw that. Well, I know that's the script, but I just wonder how long the script is going to take.
I didn't time it, but you know, it looks like it takes a long time, but that'll be probably a minute or two.
Okay. All right. In Gary time.
Yeah. So let's see how many I made people mad at me on Reddit by announcing that the show would be coming, that we're up to 17 watching now. And we've told people at our Charlotte Amateur Radio Club that this is coming up because it's pretty much all about them. Hi, everybody in my new radio club. And I even put it on, as a promo on QRZ.com, which I usually don't do. Because I think this is a topic that a lot of people will be interested in. Although on Reddit, I've been banned on Reddit for 3 days for harassment. I'm now banned for 3 days. So
who are you harassing? I can't wait to hear this. All right, it's 3 o'clock.
It's 3 o'clock.
We're here because we're here.
It's 3 o'clock in California. 6 o'clock. 6 o'clock in North Carolina.
Baltimore.
This is Ham Radio Now, the most important amateur radio program on the internet. And our show today, episode 509, December 17th, 2023. A repeater pest gets a no contact order. A.K.A. the Monkey Man trial. The Monkey Man trial. Okay, let's bring our guests in here. Oh wait, I forgot some of the most important parts here. Go ahead, David.
Yeah, there's stuff going.
Go ahead, David.
Are you sure?
Yeah,
I'm ready. All right, live from the garage below my parents' house along Mulholland Drive at the base of Santa Monica Mountains in Topanga Canyon. I'm David Goldenberg, W0DHG.
Oh, I was
without working, a title, which working, is totally fine.
Oh, I had the title up.
There you go.
I screwed things. I didn't push all the right buttons. I was trying to unpin you from that corner. From the studio in the bonus room above the garage on the north side of Fort Mill, South Carolina, in the shadow of Charlotte, in the foot of Mount Belzoni. How do I unpin? Okay, remove pin from second screen. I'm Gary Pierce, K4AAQ, the high riz, King of Ham. And now... here are our guests. In the lower left corner in Hollywood Squares is, get the right title up here, Brad Odell, KK1LL. Hello, Brad. You might have to sit up a little bit to get over your title for a moment.
Oh, hello. This is Brad, KK1LL, Charlotte, North Carolina, Mountain Island Lake.
And in the other corner, the lower left corner, is Ted Williams, no Ted Williams jokes, right? No Ted, because you've heard them all. Okay, tell people who you are.
I am Ted Williams. I am the president of the Charlotte Amateur Radio Club, and I am in Southwest Charlotte.
Okay. And once again, the show is a repeater pest, gets a no contact order. But as usual, we won't do that show first. We're going to do something else first for a minute. So, the repeater pest thing is a guy who infected a wide area coverage repeater here in the Charlotte area for years, as I understand it. So we'll talk about that in a minute. If you bear with me for a minute, a little bit of a program update, a Netflix update, Ham Radio Now episode 506. Hang on, David, say something so that you come
up. It's got to be good news because we're still on YouTube, right?
Yeah.
We haven't got kicked off yet.
We haven't been kicked off of YouTube entirely anyway. But episode 506, which got the Netflix show, All the Light We Cannot See. I think we called it All the Podcast That We Cannot See or something. How can we podcast with all this light? Episode 506, which was unceremoniously taken down by Netflix because we showed a little bit of their video. It's back. You can go watch it. It's all about a clandestine shortwave broadcaster in a small German-occupied coastal French town during World War II, and a German radio expert who is assigned to track them down. And in episode 506, we played a bunch of video from Netflix, and we commented on it. As we expected, Netflix filed a copyright infringement claim. We didn't expect Netflix would take it down. Just thought they would monetize it. Takedowns are kind of rare these days. It's usually they just collect all the money that we would have gotten from people watching the show.
Right, or the analytics.
Or the analytics, yeah. We don't make any money from people watching the show.
Right.
Because we don't monetize. And if they were to monetize, they would have collected a grand total of about 27 cents. Mm-hmm. Any case, they did the full takedown, so nobody got any money. We disputed it based on fair use, and by we, I mean I. Fair use is a detailed concept, but it basically means that we used their material for review and commentary, and we did it. And fair use allows us to use some of their material without their permission. So we don't go ask. We don't go beg. The Netflix show was a limited series. They had four episodes. Netflix, as it turns out, issued four copyright claims against us, one for each of their episodes. And initially, I filed one dispute, which turns out to be disputing and claiming fair use against just one of their episodes, and they agreed. They said, you're right. As usual, Gary, you're right. And we withdraw our copyright complaint for that one episode. But we use materials from the three other episodes as well, and they didn't withdraw their complaint from those because I didn't dispute them. So then I did, and they haven't responded yet. But because I have now disputed everything across the board on that episode, that YouTube's rules say the program being blocked will be unblocked within 48 hours, regardless of what Netflix says, while they're thinking about it. And that's what happened. So now you can go watch episode 506. Not right now. No, don't do it now. We're doing a show here. Right. Yeah, wait till we're done. And then make it a double feature. Go watch 506 afterwards. David, you got anything else before we do the big show?
No, I think we should dive right in. It's great. Great to see 26 people watching us live in the YouTube room. So
how many of you guys are from Reddit?
Yeah. Not me.
Make some comments. If you came from Reddit, make some comments because I got banned from Reddit for 3 days.
Most of the folks in the room so far had said that they don't like the Reddit.
Good. I mean, No, it's not good. I like Reddit. I spent a lot of time over there. And promoting the show wasn't what got me in trouble because we actually had a mod come on. It's the amateur radio subreddit. Actually had a mod come on and where people were saying, don't promote things on Reddit. And he said, no, he's following the rules. You can promote things as long as you actively participate in the sub in other ways.
Right.
And I do. I answer lots of questions there. And sometimes I ask some. I'm there a lot. But for some reason, my announcement attracted a major group of Reddit trolls, and they were just hammering on me, and I was answering everything because That's what one of the other things is, engage with the audience. Yeah. And, you know, be careful what you ask for. If you want me to engage with the audience, because I did. And I engaged with one person evidently a little too hard, and he complained, and they took me down, banned me for three days by harassment. They took down my comment, and then they said, you can appeal if you want to. And I filed the appeal saying, I would like to appeal, but I don't know what I said, and you took it down. And so I don't even know if I want to appeal, but I can't tell because you took it down. Okay, so.
And you like to feed the trolls.
Yep, I do
like. All right, on with the show.
On with the show. Bring our guests back. Brad, you had a comment on Reddit, right?
Oh, man, I was just thinking, you know, it's amazing. You got to watch what you say on Reddit. Meanwhile, they're posting Ukraine videos of people being blown to bits, right?
Yeah. I don't watch what I say on Reddit. I do. I mean, I do a little bit. All right, Ted, do you Reddit?
No, I don't.
Okay, so we got two no Redditors, and David will keep an eye on the chat room on YouTube to see if any of the Redditors.
So far, mostly it's thumbs down on the Redditors in the chat.
Okay, so our main topic, which by the way was repeater pest, gets a no contact order, aka the Monkey Man trial. Just to remind everybody, because memories are short. Hams are old. Memories are short. Three of us are in the Charlotte Amateur Radio Club, and I'm a new guy, but it is us. Our club operates the W4CQ repeater. It is, tell me if I get anything wrong here, it's a very wide coverage UHF repeater. Transmits from the 1,500-foot level of a broadcast tower just west of Charlotte. And I'm in the shadow of Charlotte here. It may be on the foot of, on Mount Belzoni, on the summit of Mount Belzoni. I'm not sure about that. I think it's just on a tower. Nobody's questioning my Mount Belzoni. Anybody here get the reference?
No.
It's an old Donald Fagen song, The Nightfly. Broadcasting from the foot of Mount Belzoni. I think it's fair to say that it is the busiest repeater in the metro area. It's got traffic most of the day on into the night. Is that fair?
It reaches, I'd say, from Blowing Rock to Winston-Salem to Columbia, South Carolina. Yeah. And, you know, minus geographic anomalies, pretty much everything in between. It's almost 20,000 square feet of coverage. So you're talking about
miles.
Square miles of coverage. So you're talking about, you know, using your handy talkie and reaching an audience potentially the size of, you know, bigger than most broadcast radio stations.
Yeah. And people use it all day long. A lot of repeaters are silent until rush hour. They're busy at rush hour in the morning, empty all day long, and then people pick up again when they're driving home. This repeater's got traffic, not continuously. It's not, you know, it's not every minute, but.
Well, there's someone there every minute. I guarantee you can.
Somebody listening. Yeah.
Oh yeah, for sure. For sure.
And talking maybe a conversation or two, literally every hour.
Yeah. I mean, if you're looking for a QSO, if you key the CQ, you're going to get one. Yeah. I mean,
and it's not linked to anything else. It's all by itself. So it's
its own monster repeater.
Yeah. And now I will shine a little light on a guy named Ronnie and say that without him, the repeater would be dead all day.
Well, it's not just Ronnie. There was another ham. He's still around. His name's Oscar, W4OXH. He's pushing 107 now.
Yeah.
He's working on it.
I believe he is now the oldest living ham.
Yes. So, and he's not on as much as he used to because his hearing's going, but Ronnie is also blind. The two of them are blind, and they pretty much stayed on the repeater around the clock because they stayed on the repeater around the clock. And, you know, this poking fun, we have a lot of fun out there, you know, making fun of each other and having a good time, talking about food. They kid us. They call us the Food Network a lot. but no, there's a lot of good people out there.
Yeah. And there are a few other wide coverage repeaters. There's two other repeaters on that tower, a 2-meter repeater and a 220. The 2-meter repeater gets a fair amount of activity itself, but not as much as this UHF repeater. And the 220 repeater, which has also that same awesome coverage, being 220 doesn't have nearly as many people yapping on it. We've got some linking systems that, while the individual repeaters don't have that wide coverage across their link, they do. And they tend to be pretty busy. But this repeater is the one that draws the traffic. It's
good and bad.
Yeah. Well, we're going to get into the bad. So repeaters, and especially wide coverage repeaters, are vulnerable. They're sitting ducks. Any bad actor within the repeater's footprint can disrupt the operation just by pushing their transmit button. And I think most of you in the audience have experienced this now and then on your local repeaters. David, you live in Los Angeles area, absolutely known for bad actors on repeaters.
Yep.
Is that still going on?
You know, for what you guys described as we get into this, the pest thing, there's not as much of that. There's a lot of jamming that goes on. People, you know, will key up over other people or, you know, play music or, you know, go on a rant here or there without identifying themselves. There's a lot of that goes on and off. And, you know, there's a lot of repeater systems here, but because the way the Southern California area is, there's a lot of mountain ranges. So most are linked repeaters. And when you get into that situation where somebody's having a net or other activities are going on, they'll just unlink parts, you know, if they know where the main traffic's coming in, they'll unlink it, hoping that that person isn't going to switch to another repeater that they might have access to.
Okay. Across over the years, my impression was Los Angeles got hit worse than most metro areas.
You know, with jammers, I see a jammer as a kind of a different thing than what I've heard about what was going on in your area, where, you know, again, people will like key up and play music or just, you know, key the microphone and not talk on it or make funny sounds or whatever, but not like engage in conversations or threaten people or other, you know, shenanigans, as I would call them.
Okay. I have called this guy a pest. And Brad and Ted, my impression was he couldn't jam people very well because he was on the far other side of town and he just didn't have that strong a signal. But I wasn't there for most of the activity. Did he attempt to jam people, or is pest a better characterization?
Well, no, he kind of wanted to put on his show. There was one point of time in the beginning, we didn't have control over shutting the repeater down. At least the same people, the access for it wasn't as spread as it is now. And when he would get on, there wasn't any way to stop him, and he would just go and go and go and soapbox about whatever crazy thoughts were on his mind at the time. And, you know, one of the things that he revealed was his heroes were all of the prank call people, and he listed off their names. I don't know them. They're after my time. I remember the Jerky Boys. That's about the only prank callers I remember, but evidently there's been many more since. And so at one point in time, we had a lot of theories about the guy because, you know, he was anonymous for the longest time. But I always thought that maybe he was making videos that he was going to try to monetize doing prank calls against the repeater. But, you know, now that the whole thing's played out, I realize he's just a really degenerate.
Just a sad kind of guy. Well, there's some conventional wisdom about people that jam and do all that other stuff. And that is that you just ignore it.
And no, that doesn't.
And they go away. Well, my experience is my experience is that, and the theory is the guy that just want attention. And if they don't get that attention, they don't get any feedback, then they get bored and they go away. Now, it might take a few hours, might take a few days, might even take a few weeks. But my experience is, and that there's hundreds of repeaters on the air today that have had jammers and had people play music and other crap on the air and been infecting those repeaters for a while. All those repeaters are still here. Those guys are gone. Except sometimes it doesn't work. And we're going to talk about the situation where it doesn't work. Sometimes a pest and I'm using the word pest more than jammer for the guy, for our guy, because that sounds
nut. I like nut.
Yeah. They just love what they're doing, as what you were just describing. They love their own antics. So In my script here, I'm using the word sociopath. I think maybe that's a good description. If not a little too.
Going back to what you were saying about ignoring them, in the past, that was a legitimate way to do it, you know. But now you got all these SDRs. Because I always say finding jammers is the hobby in the hobby. I've always kind of had a knack for it. But, you know, nowadays you got all these SDRs or like the W4CQ. You can listen to it online. So they can get their affirmation back without you confirming that you hear them. They know that you hear them. They know if they're jamming you out. They know if they can cover you up. Like you look at 7.2, which is like the jammer playground. It's nothing but a bunch of guys listening to their SDRs, seeing who can talk over who. And you can always tell that they're listening to themselves, because I don't know if you've ever listened to yourself talk, but you jam yourself. So you end up talking in.
Yeah. If you got a little latency,
you know, cause you're jamming. I tell you, I've been a study of the jammer for probably 4 years now. I used to encounter it in HF a whole lot. And the answer to how you fight this kind of traffic is through organization. The W4CQ club, Charlotte Amateur Radio Club, we have a large listening network of members that monitor the input frequencies. And when somebody cuts up, I send an email out to all of the members of that. We call it the Reverse Rangers, and they check their recordings. And the beauty about recording the input is you very, very rarely record anything, because it's rare that someone's close enough to you to pick them up on input. But that's how we ended up getting the Monkey Man. We got him on reverse. And then once we got him on reverse, we knew what areas to concentrate our efforts in, and we reached out to hams. I literally went to QRZ and looked for hams in that area and reached out to them individually and asked if we could listen from their station or if they would help us. And I'm telling you, the community came together. It's organization that finds corners. You can't do it by yourself. No one person.
I'm going to put the brakes on for a minute, because we're going to talk in great detail about that all the time that you want.
Okay.
But, and I am going to turn it over to you guys to talk about what happened and how things ended up, at least so far, because we don't know if he's going to come back. This is all new stuff. We're going to play a bunch of audio that you guys recorded off the repeater. And I would like to warn everybody that he was often, if not always, profane. And I did not edit out the profanity. I don't have to. We're on YouTube. I put the explicit button on our podcast. But if profanity bothers you, be aware that you're going to hear some. You're not going to hear it a lot. You know, it's not going to last forever. But we normally don't do a lot of profanity. We don't necessarily shy away from it. We just don't make it a feature of the show. And you're going to hear it from this guy. So just be aware of that. But I want to put the cart before the horse for a little bit, because our title is Repeater Pest Gets a No Contact Order. I didn't have enough room to put in from the judge, but I mean, we went to court and a judge has issued a no contact order between this guy. His name is Joshua Duffy. We're not going to hide that. And you, Brad, you filed for this no contact order, and we were going to work our way through what it took to get there. So it was Joshua Duffy. His call was KQ4GAD. Yep. He was a ham. He wasn't a ham when this all started. And it got to the point, I think, because I wasn't here for most of this. It didn't start out with him harassing you, right, Brad? But it ended up that way.
It started off the day after Christmas. And we actually thought he was really drunk. We thought he was another ham that unfortunately kind of sounded like him. Remember that, Mr. Freeze? Can you remember that there, Mr. President? And, you know, eventually we cleared the other guy's name once we figured out it wasn't him, because they were both on at the same time, luckily. Like I said, it all started with finding him on reverse. And once we got that hit in reverse, we would literally, he would come on and go on a tirade.
Again, hang on, because I only want to talk about the court stuff right now.
The court stuff.
Yeah. So how did you end up finding a way to take him to court? Because you can't take somebody to court for radio stuff.
The FCC says
that they own all that.
Okay. Well, so the FCC actually, after exhausting everything with the FCC, the fox hunting, all of that, where I was going with this, with the story, at the end of that, all we could get the FCC to do was send letters. And you actually have audio of Guffey taunting us about the letters, like basically telling me and Lisa, that's the head of enforcement over there. Laura, that's right. To tally it up. Then he sang us the "It's All About the Money" song. Yeah, I'm sure you heard that one.
Okay, that's what that came from. All right.
That's what that came from. Yeah, I can translate lots of the ramblings. I'm fluent in monkey man. Yeah, but it was actually Riley that Riley Hollingsworth said, some of the things that he said were actually threatening. Like, he threatened to shoot me in the head, basically. And, you know, that carries weight as far as something that could be enforced. Because we've said it, the police, the Matthews police went to his house many times on welfare checks. But there was never any, they had no reason to stop him. All they could do is knock on the door. If he goes on now, and the order isn't just about me. It's actually, if you read it, it says he can't go onto the club's repeater system. So if he goes back on again, it'll be an arrestable charge.
So the restraining order wasn't specifically about you. It was you, and it included the repeater as well, which was
It specifically says the club's repeater systems.
Okay.
Yeah, actually, I can show what that looks like. How did you get to the point where the idea was to get a no contact order?
Like I said, that was Riley. Riley said that, you know, if you got to do something with local law enforcement, and then and like I said, some of those recordings are talking about guns and shooting people and whatnot, and that's more than enough in North Carolina. It doesn't matter if it's a fax, an email, a phone call, or, you know, saying it to someone's face. You can't make threats like that, as empty as they were.
Okay, I'm bringing up the court order. Put it on the screen here.
Are there other repeaters that he could just migrate to that cover that area, or at least in where he is?
Yes, and he has. Oh, okay. He's bothered our buddies over at Fleet Talk a whole bunch. But the beauty of it is him having the no contact with me. I've already talked to Fleet Talk. If he starts showing up over there, I'll just show up too. Then he's got to go.
You show up too. And once you're on the repeater, it kind of covers.
He's got to go.
Got it.
This is the no contact order. It's down here where they added, got to stay off the repeater. Not use.
I should say the club repeaters.
Yeah, the club repeater system. Okay. So, so he's prohibited from doing that by the court, which is an interesting thing. I don't know if the FCC is ever going to have heartburn about a court trying to enforce a radio thing. I don't know. Maybe someday they will.
I don't think they would, seeing that everybody was a person and this guy was actually threatening other people. So, you know, I don't see where they would have a problem with it. Use of the radio is free, but using it for abusive tendencies is not. So I don't think they would have a clear and present problem with it. They may have a problem because we're restricting somebody from using their radio, but when you're using it in a content of, you know, threatening people, and then I don't see where they would have a problem with it myself. Not saying that they would or they wouldn't.
I'm just saying, we're not lawyers and we're not the FCC, and you know, who knows what they considers someone stepping on their jurisdiction. In any case, you got the idea that use the local law enforcement to go to get this no contact order, and you attempted to do that. And then what happened?
Let's see. Well, we showed up a few times because he kept ducking service, but we eventually got him served.
Yeah. So we were there. We showed up at court twice.
Yes.
Yeah, and he apparently knew how the system worked.
Oh yeah, he sent me some emails in the interim, kind of taunting me, and he'd come on the repeater, That was one of the things that he would do that made it a little bit easier is if we sent the cops to his house, he'd come on the repeater and talk about it just so that it would confirm that, yes, we got the right guy. You know, that's one thing about fox hunting somebody. When we fox hunted the guy, we got to a street, then we started knocking doors and asking neighbors who's the drunk on their street is kind of how we found the house itself. You know, we had videos of, you know, sitting with the handy talkie in front of the house with the echo between the input and the repeater to show that we're right on it. You know, there's, it's hard to put somebody at the mic, right? But we never had to with this guy because no matter what he did, he would have immediately come on the mic and confirm it.
Yep.
You know,
and you took all that to court. He had all that evidence ready to show the judge.
That's right. And they hired an attorney.
Yeah. Okay. So hang on. Yeah. I'm building the suspense.
Okay.
We're storytelling here.
All right.
We get to court. It was just last Thursday, a couple days ago, get to court. And as we're standing outside the courtroom, this has happened twice before. What they do is they send somebody out and they start calling names of the people that have business before the court. And they call your name and you say you're here. And they call Joshua Duffy and for two appearances in a row, no answer. He's not there. And they say, well, he was not served. Whoever goes out and serves the summons that he's supposed to come to court, they never found him. And we suspect, I think, he, you know, was just good at ducking it, you know, peeking out the window. Oh, sheriff's coming. I'm going to hide, not answer the door. We don't know. We weren't there. We don't know that that's what happened. We suspect. That's what happened. So you're getting wise to this. And then you had to do something to make sure he was going to get served. You're learning. He knew the system. You're learning the system. What did you learn?
Well, one, I mean, he knew the system because of his prior. I mean, did I send you that? That he was.
I've seen it.
His last charge was basically calling 911 and putting the same shtick on that he was doing on the repeaters.
He was doing that one on the 911.
Yeah, he was calling. Yeah, back in, I guess this was in 2019. He was calling 911. The charge sheet says talking about midgets and drive-through. So, you'll see. He has some kind of perversion for midgets and Star Wars is a lot of recurring theme in his traffic, if you want to call it that.
So you learned that you needed to get him served somehow. How did you accomplish that? Since you've been,
I've got some attorney friends that have paper hangers, and we had a professional go serve him.
They waited him out.
Yeah, they found him.
Yeah. Okay, so now we're in court, and this third time, people are calling out the names, and they call his name and his attorney. Response for him.
Yes. So then that's what I'm sweating. I'm like, oh, this guy's going to pick me to pieces. I know how attorneys work. You know, it's just like I was saying, you know, he could make it into a large difficulty for me or whatever, but okay. Ultimately
easy. I'm stringing them out because this is what they got mad at me on Reddit for. Cause I didn't tell them the whole story. I told them pieces of the story and, okay, Brad, you got to talk because David bumped his microphone and put his face on the screen.
Okay, I'm here.
There you're right. That brings you back. The Reddit folks got mad at me for not telling them the whole story. David, anybody from Reddit yet? In the chat room? No one is willing to fess up to be in Reddit? Okay. So we leave the hallway. We go into the courtroom. The first business is they're looking for who didn't show up and they dismiss cases. They do that for about 30 minutes or so. And then they start taking the cases where the people are all there. And we were not first. There were, what, four, maybe five cases that came up before that?
Oh, yeah.
And you're listening to them.
I learned something.
Yeah.
So the division of the court that we were in handles two things. Non-contact orders and domestic violence. And in these cases...
How the heck did ham radio get into domestic violence?
Well non-contact order and or.
Right.
So in both of these situations, at least one party is crazy. You know, I mean, if not both, at least one, or you wouldn't be there. And we watched a bad breakup couple fight over, it was hamsters, I want to say, for 30 minutes. I don't think I could take hearing the word hamster. Yeah,
it's either gerbils or
gerbils or hamsters or whatever it was. Yeah.
Some little rodent.
Very petty things.
Yeah. You didn't take them and I'm allergic. And the judge, I was watching the judge. The judge was doing this a lot.
Yeah.
But eventually she comes up with a decision in each one of those cases. And one person goes away happy and one person goes away unhappy. One of the things that I was learning as we were doing that is the judge listened to their stories.
No matter how crazy.
A good long time. And some of these people had lawyers and some didn't. And we only saw one case where they brought up a witness and they did, and neither party had a lawyer. So the individuals, the plaintiff and the defendant, got to ask questions of the witness. And the plaintiff, the guy, I thought, you know, he's either watched a lot of lawyer shows or had some legal training or something, because he was pretty good at it. And in any case, we saw that you could do that. And so that's given me some hope that all of your evidence, your mountain of evidence and recordings.
Yeah.
I'm thinking, Alice's restaurant right now, you know, the 37, 8x10 color glossy photos with circles and arrows and explanations on the back. And the judge comes in and he's blind and it's another case of American blind justice. Our judge was not blind. And, you're maybe going to get that in. And then I'm worrying, yeah, but is anybody going to understand it? Because it's all technical stuff. Sort of tech. I mean, some of it is definitely not.
Well, I think the recordings speak for themselves. Yeah. Remember, we're not there trying to make the judge understand what radio is. We're just showing that he's being harassing.
Yeah. So you got all that ready. And we're going to play a lot of that coming up. And remember, it's profane. So be ready. So you get called.
Oh, yeah.
Your turn.
Okay.
What happened?
I'm going to go all the way this time.
Yeah, it's all yours.
Okay, all right. So I go up there. I've got my laptop. I'm ready to play all of these horrible, shocking files. I've got copies of where his last ticket for calling 911. I've got letters from the police department. I've got everything. I got the FCC letters, cease and desist, everything. His attorney comes up there and just throws the towel in. It just absolutely says, we're not going to contest anything. We're willing to sign the order. Basically, now this is just me spitballing here, and help me out, Ted. It looked like, from what we gather, he lives in a house that's owned by his mother, who doesn't live with him. And it looked like mom was there cleaning up after him that day. There was a nicer looking older woman there that seemed like she was kind of caring, taking after him. And as Ted said, before the attorney went up there and threw the towel in, he looked over his shoulder at her and she gave him the nod. But I tell you, at the end of the day, that's who I feel sorry for on all of this, is his mother. She seemed like a good person.
Yeah. We don't know for sure that it was his mom. We're assuming.
Looked like her.
Yeah. You know, based on age and how she was dealing with him.
Our personality only a mother could love.
I'm sorry. Go ahead, Ted.
If she wasn't his mother, she was calling the shots. She kept him quiet when he was outside, had him sit there, made him sit up when he was in the back. If he leaned over or slouched a little bit, she kept him straight. So
you're keeping an eye on them. I wasn't watching them.
Yeah, I was watching them.
Yeah. All right. So so the lawyer, the first thing he does is say, we agree to no contact. But he had some conditions.
Well, no findings of law. He did not want the judge. He didn't want those recordings played. So, and the other thing too, that, and I had to weigh this, was as satisfying as it would have been to play it to the judge, we would have actually got less out of it, because all I could ask for was a no contact with me. They offered to add in the clause of not being able to come onto the club repeaters. And so for that, you know, that's an extra win for me. So we'll just have to play all the recordings here. where everyone can hear him instead of the eight people that were left in the courtroom anyways. Yep.
So he started a claim no contest and then just wanted to settle with you guys before it got judged.
Not no contest. He maintains his innocence, but he just didn't want the judge to hear and make a ruling. He's just willing to say, we agree. We're going to go ahead and give it. Because otherwise, all that would have happened was the judge would have ordered him to sign it instead of him just signing it willing.
And he sort of maintains his innocence, but we're going to hear in a minute where he does admit to a lot of what he did. So, they offer the no contact with the conditions of we're done. You know, and we're not going to put anything more in the record. And that was okay with you.
Like I said, I think that's the best outcome for the club.
Yeah.
Like I said, I'm not out here for retribution. I'm not out here to punish. I wanted to make a problem go away.
Yeah. And there's pretty good reason to think that has happened, but not 100%, because he could still come back, because he still has a problem. We'll talk about his problem in just a minute. So you stayed in the courtroom to get paperwork. And I was thinking, do I want to go try to talk to him, get him on camera or not? I'm a chicken poop guy, but I'll go up and give this a try. And so I get my phone ready to record on video. And I came up to him and I introduced myself, you know, Gary Pierce, K4AAQ. I do the Ham Radio Now podcast. Can I talk to you on camera? And he is, no, I don't want to do video, but you can record audio. Bing, bing, bing. Fine with me. We'll do some audio. And I talked to him for a pretty short period of time, but here it is. Okay, you are Joshua Duffy. What's your call sign?
KQ4GAD.
You entered voluntarily into a no contact order with Brad O'Dell.
Well, provisionally, that there was no findings.
Yeah, they didn't find it.
Right, that was, why didn't he play Two Live Crew, talk about profanity, he talked about assault, and talking about threatening people with firearms, which was inaccurate, but yeah.
Can you tell me about what you have interacted with the W4CQ repeater in the past?
Just, they said get your license, I got it, but I have a problem with alcoholism, and so, it didn't jive. Getting drunk on there was not cool, and that's basically the whole thing.
So you made transmissions on the air that you're not proud of,
right? Profanity, drunk, you know, just being crazy, stupid. It was totally just random.
And what's your goal in the future?
I am not going to be on like HF or any, I'm not going to be transmitting like that at all in the future. I mean, it was just like, I got it in the SDR after exploring like Wi-Fi, Bluetooth stuff and some other stuff like that. And it was just kind of as part of exploring the frequency spectrum.
Okay. So you intend to keep using your ham license?
I probably won't renew it, but yeah, I mean, it's still active, I think.
All right. Thanks for talking to us. Yeah. He's walking away at that point. There's a few things to unpack in there. Up front, he talks about the things that he was expecting you to bring up, to charge him with.
That's right. Pretty good mind reader, right?
Yeah. And you were speculating to me that maybe he was prepared for some kind of testimony.
Yeah. Like I said, I feel like just the way that he was being managed by people the whole time, I think that, you know, it's at some point in time, any good attorney would have sat him down and said, you know, if they don't take this deal, you're going to have to speak. And these are the things that you're going to have to address. And they probably went through it. And, you know, we were up there for hours. He sat through all of that court and he never got to say anything. And then you gave him his chance to dump it on out there. And I think you just got it all at once.
Yeah, that could be, again, we don't know, but it kind of sounds that way. And then, I turn out to be a pretty passive aggressive interviewer, I think. I'm giving him a little bit of question to let him tie the rope and tighten the knot. You know, what did you do? And what was the problem? And that's when he gets into, well, alcohol, you know, he's got an alcohol problem. And what did you get on the air and do? You know, well, profanity, you know, let me see what did he
do? I like when you ask him what he's going to do in the future. It's like, well, I've jammed 911. I've jammed ham radio. I think I'm going to go into public announcement jamming next. I'll be at the bus station.
At the airport.
I'll be farting into the bus station, Mike.
Yep. Okay. So, and he mentions in the middle that he got his ham license. That's an unusual wrinkle I think we'll get into as you give us the entire history in four-part harmony of going back to Alice's restaurant, of what happened. Because I think everybody wants to hear all the details of what happened and how we got there.
I hope you didn't come to a W4CQ ham radio class to get his license.
Oh, no. No, we would have known that voice. We still haven't had any of the QRM yet. You keep teasing us with it. Where's all this profanity you promised us?
Well, yeah, what happened to his jamming, Gary?
Okay, does everybody want to hear a little bit of the...
clear my name and of being a liar and accusing him of this? What? So
well, I think live, it's important to introduce the evidence as
yeah, exactly.
Okay, so I've got a bunch here. Let's see. I've got something I'm calling an insults medley. I've got about five or six different pieces.
Medley.
You know,
sounds like a salad.
Or a concert.
Insult salad.
Yeah, an insult salad. Let's listen to this is him on the air. And once again, I don't know if this one has profanity or not. Most of them do. So this is the insults medley.
You are the creepiest son of a bitch in 9 counties. You're all midgets. You're all a bunch of Ewoks. Bring your old dead dad here. Bring all the tombstones you got. Bring whatever you got. Bring everything you got. And I'll prove you wrong. You're all things that people on fuck all you assholes. KQ4TAD, Gossad, New York has best of the best of the best. First. In last five.
What a trip down memory lane there.
Yeah. At that point, he had his ham license. When this started, he didn't.
Yeah, that's when we caught him. When we caught him, he decided that it would absolve himself if he got the license. And the crazy part was, I mean, somewhere I've got the recording. He actually came on the night before he took the test and talked about, tomorrow I'm going to take the test and I'm going to be absolved of everything. I'm just going to tell him I didn't know I wasn't supposed to do all that stuff and I'm going to be good from here on. He came back in with that darn license the next day and Ted had to run him off. The next day, he didn't even have that license for a day. The ink didn't dry.
Yeah, he didn't know what it was all about, I guess. He was, deluding himself. So you guys have told him to get off the repeater. A repeater owner, trustee, the club that owns the repeater, has the authority to tell someone to stop using the repeater. And you guys did that multiple
certified
times.
Certified letters.
Yeah, and on the air.
This I am requesting you to abide by the FCC rules and do not get on the repeater until we go further into this matter and get everything relinquished, okay? We can get together on a personal basis with the club, and I'll sit down with you and explain the situation. This is Kilowatt Echo 6, Quebec Echo Yankee, Charles signing off.
Yes, I would like to speak to those people in Turkey who had an earthquake and just like see you know what all that kind of stuff is like.
Well, I'm gonna tell you right now, I am not going to get into a long conversation with you. If you want to talk to the people in Turkey, you're not going to do it on this repeater. Okay? So cease and desist the use of the repeater. You can look me up. I'm on QRZ. Give me an email, and I'll call you back, and we'll set up a meet, and me and you can sit down and talk. But right now, stay off the repeater. You copy?
Yes, I understand what you are saying.
Doesn't understand.
KQ4GAD. I don't know. Is this in the amateur band?
Okay, now you're just playing with me. Get off the repeater and don't get back on there. Case is QEY, I'm clear.
And there was one more.
Yes, sir. I can hear you.
Well, you should have came back with your call sign. We've been having problems on this repeater, and we'd like you to relinquish the use of the repeater until we get everything straight, okay? I am the president of the Whiskey Ford Charlie Quebec, the Charlotte Amateur Radio Club, and we'd like you to stop the repeater until we get everything squared away with you there. Roger?
Yes, I understand what you are saying, but my email has been delayed, and I have to go ahead and log in and see if I can pay my $35.
Okay, it's not an issue of your payment as far as a club member. It's an issue of what you have done in the past on the repeater over the past couple of months. That's the issue. Now, if you would like to, I would be welcome to sit down with you and explain the situation to you. But for now, you need to cease and desist on use of the repeater until we get this matter squared away. You copy?
I understand what you're saying, that, yes, they wrapped a whole bunch of wire around me, and that electroshock overrode what I was actually doing at the time, at the present time. Thank you.
What? he is. I don't know if it's by accident. He can go off on tangents and just keep on going. Almost sounds like he's talking to you, and then he's in outer space.
Dips. Yep. He'll dip right out of there on you.
Yep. Okay. I have one that's called Cussing at KK1LL. So this is definitely going to be some serious profanity. So once again, if you've got kids nearby, turn up the volume.
God damn it, man. Brad, can't you just tell me the fucking whatever? Christ almighty. Can't you tell me the goddamn numbers to put in to talk to my dad up in Jonas Ridge?
Oh, I guess that was it. I've got a little more, but what I want you guys to do is to start telling us the story, and then we'll play a little bit more.
Give us the one that's. That would have got him in the court. Give us the one with the gun threat to me personally.
Ah, okay. So
then I'll feel absolved from him calling me a liar.
Here's the threats, guns, and whirly bird nonsense.
No. Well, that's one of them. But the one to it'd be is the pop my head like a pimple one.
I don't have one labeled that.
Yeah, let me look at. What?
Wait, he sent that to you, Gary. That was in the email yesterday.
Yeah, that's a good.
Well, that's the magic bullet. That's the one that the judge would have issued the order.
Okay. Let me dig up the email, because I might not have that set up as something to play, but I'll see if I can pull it up. This will take a moment.
I don't see it in your list.
Yeah, this is.
Can you, Can you give us a melody while you're looking?
Yeah, I'm
a big fan of the remixes.
Oh yeah, I can. You know, we play something else while I'm looking for that. See what happens. So this will be the one that says threats, guns, and Whirlybird nonsense.
Whirlybird is his drone, by the way. Oh, this is it.
You blame the boy over the roar. Don't blame me. Don't blame me. I got a full clip of bullets with like waiting for Brandon Lee. I will pop your head like a pimple. Gun owner myself. I own a gun. I own a gunpowder projectile firing weapon too myself. But I have a lot of money here. You know, like I have quite a bit of appliance on my radio stuff. And if you do, you might have somebody who wants to come and take it. But you can answer that. Need to. I don't ever take my gun anywhere. They got a conceal and carry, but I don't have that at all.
Put your Whirlybird in the head. I'll put your Whirlybird right on your tower. I'll fly right up to your tower and take pictures of it all day long.
All right.
Vindicated.
Yeah. Because that's a pretty direct threat.
Well, yeah, I mean, but when he says serious. Like Brandon Lee was shot to death. Yeah. You know, I mean.
And so we have played enough that people are probably getting the idea that, oh yeah, this guy is a pest. He is serious. But I don't think, no matter how much we play, they're going to get the idea that he was there, what, night after night, day after day, month after month?
Well, he had conscious hours, and then he would sleep for some period. And then, by God, he'd be back, wouldn't he, Ted? Well, yeah. Man, he would be back.
I have a wonder and a question that, it's clear you guys have not spent a lot of time in court, and I don't spend a lot of time in court, but I do spend some. I wonder when the other attorney, when his attorney offered to, hey, they'll just sign this, and essentially they did plead no contest. If them agreeing to sign basically said, yeah, you've got him. And I wondered, and it may just be because you guys went in on your own without an attorney to represent you.
That's correct.
And I wonder, had you had that, I'm pretty sure your attorney would have said, no, thank you. Let's play this and get the judge to hear it and order it. Cause it may or may not have come with more weight had the judge heard it. And there may have been more extreme repercussions, not for you guys, but for him, having heard that open threat.
And I thought that too, but also at the same time, if I didn't take that deal, I could almost assure you that that attorney would have said, well, we need a continuance and we need discovery.
Yeah, no, I get your point. I totally
you know, that. And like I said, I mean, I'm just one guy, dude.
With the with them asking for the continuance, I think if the judge had heard that, he still would have issued the no contact. I don't know if he would have included the clause to say he can't be on your repeater, but mm-hmm. he surely would have issued a note. I don't know if no contact's like what we have in California called a restraining order, but he would have issued it. And you know what? You guys got it ultimately. And then now the question is, you guys listening for him all the time. Is he going to show up again? And then what's the repercussions if he shows up?
Oh, that's easy. The Matthews Police Department is just waiting for the call.
They're waiting.
Trust me, it's he's been a nuisance to them as much as he has to us.
So he'll violate the no contact order.
He'll violate an order, then he'll be in contempt.
He'll be in contempt. Okay.
Okay. You have called him the Monkey Man, and we have an email that he is saying that. And not quite that you're a racist. I think I might have that.
I didn't name him. The collective named him.
Yeah, let me see if I can find that.
He named himself.
Yeah, I think this is it. I still haven't seen the summons for court. This is email he sent to you.
Oh, yeah.
I still haven't seen the summons for court. If you wait till the last minute to do that, the judge will extend the hearing date. He knew what was going on. And Publishing Monkey Man says something about your character. So now let's see why you guys, well, you say that he named himself.
By action.
Okay, so this is one sample of that, just one quick sample.
Unidentified station, please provide a call sign.
L-U-C-K-G-O-D. And who in the hell are you? Who is this, sir?
Okay, so he did that all the time.
Is that call sign open?
It doesn't begin with a W, K, A, or N, so I'm not sure. Not sure. Wow. It's something we can use. But he made the noises himself. So we got a lot of what he did, what he sounded like, and we know what happened. Now it's time to go back to the first time you heard him and take us through how you caught him.
Man.
Yes. Everybody pops some popcorn and settle back.
Let's pick it up when we got him on reverse, because that's where we left off the last. You know, he'd come on, he'd run his mouth, everyone would listen on reverse. And I don't want to put any other hams' calls out there, but we'll just say that a lot of other hams were involved in. We were lucky enough to get a hit out in Stallings, a good strong hit in Stallings, and from there we,
the repeater is about 20 miles west of town. Now, it's up 1,500 feet, but it's about 20 miles west of town.
Yeah, and Stallings is another 20 miles east of town.
Yeah, so he's quite a bit east. So he's probably 40 miles from the repeater, and you could tell on a lot of those recordings his signal was weak. It's noisy.
Just on a handy talkie and sitting on his couch.
Yeah. But I'm guessing he moved around some, maybe, you know, in the car.
I don't think he ever leaves that house, dude.
Well, because the quality of his audio changes. It sounds like different radios and sometimes...
Maybe from bathroom to bedroom to couch, man. Okay. I'm telling you.
All right. So you're... Go ahead, Ted. I'm sorry.
He could have been slumped over with the handy talkie. But it was all done ahead. And I don't think he ever left his neighborhood.
I don't think he leaves that house.
Yeah. You know, when he was doing it.
Okay. Because that's most of the time, that's about the signal you'd get into this wide coverage repeater from a handheld. And that's why I wasn't calling him a jammer, because almost everybody could override him. But when you were done overriding him, he was still there. So it didn't do any good. All right. So people listened for him on the repeater input on reverse.
Well, once we started getting hits and Stallings, then a handful of us got together. It's probably about six or seven of us. And we said, we're going to meet for breakfast early in Stallings. We're going to spread out around the area. It's not a big town, and just listen. And sure enough, it came on, and we just kept, you know, getting a little closer until, we were on a street. We made it to his street.
Did he have a time of day that he was typically on there?
Man, it was absolutely random. It was absolutely random. But he had been the day that we decided to hunt him, we actually went out there 2 days in a row and he never came on, and it was really disheartening. And then the third day that we were out there, he came on and we were close and we were on him quick. Like I said, we got to his street. I used a 705 and a Yagi. You can turn the AF gain way down on it, make it really weak for direction finding. And then once we got close, we just started knocking doors and saying, hey, you know, we've got this guy that's basically a prank caller. You know, do you have a really awful drunk jerk around here? And I mean, it's, we had everyone sent us to the same house, you know.
This was all before he was licensed.
This is before he is licensed.
Because once he got his license, he was on, you guys already knew who he was. And so he was.
Yeah, that's why I didn't mind giving his call, because I'd already been to his house. I'd already knocked on his door.
Yeah.
Matter of fact, he was on. He was doing his shtick on the radio when I banged on the door.
How many doors did you have to knock on before you found the right house?
10, 12, something like that.
10 or 12.
Yeah.
Anybody but point you in that direction, or just happened to find him?
Well, no, like I said, we got close with the fox hunting, but once you get so close, then what do you do? It's like, yeah, he's right on us, but we're in the middle of a neighborhood, you know?
Mm-hmm.
So like I said, I just started knocking doors. It's like someone who does this isn't going to be just our problem. You know, he's got to be a problem for the neighbors too. And it didn't take long. No.
Well, so one of the neighbors said, go check over there.
Four of the neighbors said, go
check. Four of the neighbors
said, yeah. So, yeah. And then from there, you know, matter of fact, Ronnie was on the radio with him. And I said, Ronnie, tell me what he does. I went up and I beat on the door. And Ronnie said he could hear me knocking. And he said, goodbye forever. And he turned the radio off and hid under his bed. And then we started with the FCC. You know, we sent all the recordings. We sent videos. They told us to send cease and desist letters. Sean sent those certified mail. He got on the air, talked about how he got them. Like I said, everything that we did, he got on the air immediately and confirmed that it was done. You know,
this is the cease and desist.
And he's getting similar letters from Fleet Talk, because we're working with Fleet Talk hand in hand, because he's doing the same thing to them.
Yeah. So it says, as trustee of the W4CQ repeater system located at 444.450 megahertz, I am demanding that you refrain from using or interfering or otherwise engaging with the repeater system operating on that frequency, and et cetera.
That's Sean's letter there.
Yeah.
Okay. Now you said he's on that other repeater system, but if you move over there and you're on that repeater system, then he's got the stay away order. Is that enforceable?
Absolutely.
And so are you on there and just putting out your call sign?
Well, no, like I said, I told John and them, if you start having a problem with him over there, just give me a call. I really honestly think that I'm knocking on wood, and I will say that this guy has surprised me in what he will do, but I really think he's gone. I think now that mom's been involved, that's kind of where it ended with 911. Mm-hmm. He made it all the way to court with 911. There hasn't been any more 911 calls. So now he's made it to court. Maybe that's the finish line.
I see.
Yeah.
One could
hope. Okay. So you identified him. The neighbors pointed you to the right. Did you confront him on that first attempt?
I knocked on his door, but he didn't come to the door. He just hid. And, you know, from there, like we went to the FCC. FCC ended up, let's see, we found him in February. April, the letter from the FCC went out from April. He got another letter at the end of November.
You know, so they did send a letter, but they didn't do much.
They sent two letters.
They sent two letters. Okay.
Stop, or I'll say stop again. And then they said stop again.
Yeah.
So,
and then they told you, and then they
which
told
completes
you
to, the entire circle of what the FCC does.
FCC was gonna do. And then they told you to tell them to cease and desist. And then at that point, you had nothing better.
Well,
to do.
No, I mean, at that point in time, Laura stopped talking to me altogether. You know, and like, this is just kind of over with and done with. And that's when Riley said, you know, as a friend, he said, you know, this guy's making direct threats, maybe go after him with local law enforcement. It's like, yeah, it's a good idea. Of course, my wife thought it was a good idea too, because even though I don't take the threats that seriously, my wife does. Sure. And you know, I'm only about 40% of the decision making in that capacity of this house. So,
lucky
so we're scared for our life because she says we are.
Yeah, well,
that was something that we discovered in court as well. That one of the things that the judge threw out someone's request because they weren't scared enough.
Yeah, they weren't scared. Sorry, you're not scared enough.
Yeah. So you So you learn from that. You know, the person that they weren't scared enough of was not threatening to shoot them.
Yeah.
Or do bodily harm.
Yeah. And so you had that in your back pocket.
My fence with your trampoline.
Trampoline is a court story.
Yeah, that was a pretty.
Oh, please. Let's not go into that.
Yep. Yeah. There's some TV shows, some of the judge TV shows, the fake judge TV shows that that show these kind of folks. They amp it up, or you think that they amp it up on TV. They don't amp it up on TV. These people are out there. They're real. Okay, so you've encountered him the first time. At some point you're going through Laura Smith. Do you ever go back to his house?
No need to. Well, the best thing is once we knew where he was at, it was easy to find hams that were close to him. So if we ever needed confirmation, if he was on, the easiest way to do it is if you're listening to the input, there's a delay between the input and the repeater signal. And like, I don't know if you noticed, but during the one where he made the monkey man sounds that got him his name, if you notice that delay between the two, he's got his truck radio's on the repeater and his handy talkie's on the input. So he's showing that he's right in front of the guy's house. See what I'm saying?
Yeah. Okay. So, you got plenty of ways to prove for sure that he is who he thinks he is. Would you like to hear a little more?
Oh, sure.
Some of the guys in the chat were saying he's playing music too.
Oh yeah. Two Live. He likes Two Live Crew. We got a lot of Two Live Crew.
Yep.
And then I can't remember the comedy tape. It was a black woman and a black man, and they were really, really filthy, like from the 70s.
Okay, this one is called Sex and Nonsense Medley.
We fuck your mama.
Hey, I dare you to get on here and say, I got a... Wait, what is it? I got 12 dick and a dozen roses and a pickup truck. Oh, I love it. 'Cause I hate Chewbacca. 'Cause you're like, you know, like all those 10-foot tall people, like, that came in there and raped all those babies, you know? I hate Chewbacca. And I'll fight you for Chewbacca. To be honest with you, the Harlem Globetrotters can burn in hell. For pushing Mary off a building, and then the silly putty people got a bunch of Harlem Globetrotters to rape the Virgin Mary and, like, put on silly putty while they were beating her to death.
Yeah, he's got problems.
The irony that he looks like Mark Hamill and he talks about Star Wars.
that is weird. David, what are they saying over there in the chat room?
Oh, there's a lot of stuff about he needs help, and, you know, lucky his mom saved him. And they said stuff about, you know, them playing music and maybe telling the property owner that he's doing this stuff there. But I'll
the mom is the property somebody owner. Else.
Yeah, right. The mom, and then I guess she found out, right? And hopefully she took some things, and, you know, stuff about.
Hopefully she took away his PlayStation or something. I don't know. Right,
and, you know, the hard thing about getting people like this help, you know, when I was a kid, you know, they still had sanitariums, and, you know, people that were messed up like this, they'd put them in there whether they wanted to be there or not. And we don't do that anymore, you know. And I saw some recommendations about, you know, sending the guy, court can send him to 12-step. Problem is, doing a 12-step program, you have to be willing. You have to want to do it. If you don't want to do it, you don't go willingly, it ain't going to help you.
Well, I have some input on that because I am a recovering alcoholic. 1988 was the last time I used any intoxicating substances other than what they stuck into me at a hospital for surgery and stuff. And there were plenty of people that were in the AA programs by court order. Some, it worked on some of them, and it probably didn't work on most of them, but it worked on some of them. So it's something that they try. And as far as you know, alcohol is concerned, and this guy, he's still active, as far as we can tell. But if he's as alcoholic as he sounds, he won't be in control of what he does next. Maybe his mom can control him, but you will hear in the world of alcoholism, it is replete with people who cannot be controlled. So that's why the idea that he is gone, it will be great if he is. It will not be surprising if he's not. Because if he's still got his radio, and one night he's going to be drunk and he won't be able to stop himself. So we'll see. There'll be consequences, but and nobody in the alcoholic community excuses their behavior because they were drunk. That is not an excuse. It's an explanation, but it's not an excuse. So I would like to see him get help. And Duffy, if you're watching, KN4AQ at ARVN.TV, I will help you get help if no one else does, if you want it.
Do it for your mama.
Yeah.
Do it for your mother.
It saved.
He's got to do it for himself.
Yeah, he does. And I had to do it for myself. I was active alcoholic for 10 years, and I knew it was getting worse and worse and worse. And I was absolutely unwilling to do anything about it until what they say is you hit bottom. And some of us have a relatively high bottom, and I was lucky because my bottom did not involve drugs It did not involve jail or court or anything like that. I was lucky because it could have gone there, and his could go there. I don't know. He's been to court plenty now, but it could get worse, or this may be where he turns around. And just find your local AA, and they will help you. So that's my plea to him and anybody out there, anybody in the audience that has a problem like that. If you're recognizing it, you can get help and your life can get better. Doesn't seem like it now, but it can. And I'll stop my sermon. So is there any more to tell of the story of between when you found him and when you got to court?
No, I think you put a pretty neat bow on it just now. I mean, there's really nothing exciting to say about it. It's just, we just had to just keep repeating the same actions until something happened. I will remind everybody out there that if there's another QRMer out there that's doing this to somebody else, this guy could have walked away 100 times and we would have never got him. All he had to do is go away. Mm-hmm. So I don't know, but we'll be listening.
The last thing I want to add then is this was a solution for you. And this thing is this kind of thing, jamming, music, whatever, bad actors, pests, is still going on across the country, comes and goes. I think the advice to begin with is still ignore it. You get on the air and you taunt him and you claim you're going to find him and you're not really going about finding him. All the things that hams say out of frustration because they gotta do something and all they got to do is talk on their microphone because they really don't have anything to back it up. We're going to direction find you, but you don't have any direction finding equipment. Ignore him is your first step, and that is really hard to do. And maybe your second and third step. If that doesn't work, you have some special circumstances. Your circumstances got you to the point where you could file a no contact order because of harassment. If somebody's listening to this out there and they've got that problem, maybe they can get the guy to start harassing somebody.
Well, I mean, just jamming is harassment. I mean, if you can prove that it's going, if you can put someone at the mic, I mean, it's the pursuit of happiness minus infringing on somebody else's, right? You can't just mess with people like that.
But you had this guy because you had threats of physical violence. Other than that,
well, I had him cold because of that. But harassment,
exactly. But the point is, if the FCC was never going to do anything for you, right? And you could ask him to cease and desist.
He
could have done that or not. But the taking him to court and the no contact order, that was your checkmate, right? And that only was successful because you guys had clear recordings of threats of physical violence. And sadly, you had to get to that. And, you know, sorry for your wife's perspective on it all, right? Because you understand how that goes. But that was really what it took. And we had some of that. We've had some of that here. And mostly that stuff came down because they went and found the person, and then the threat started. And, you know, you go knock on somebody's door, and that door that may or may not be armed, that's, you know, could be touch or go.
Well, just know that.
And I'm glad it worked out for you.
The kind of cases that are being heard in that courtroom is, if you send flowers to somebody every day that doesn't want flowers, you can get one of these orders against you. The bottom line is there's no way to willingly cause someone else duress without repercussion. You know, just because it doesn't break an FCC rule doesn't mean it breaks, doesn't break the rules of the land, lay of the land. And there was actually two court cases that I had written down to cite in case he tried to throw it out saying it's a federal issue. But there's been two other QRM, one in Florida, one in Tennessee, where they claimed that the state had no jurisdiction over the case because it was federally regulated. And they said, no. Harassment's harassment. You committed harassment in our county, so there you go. But either way.
Okay. So if you're having this trouble, at least be aware that this was a solution at one point for one circumstance. Maybe for you. Maybe you haven't thought about doing it that way. So, David, have you noted how many people are tuned in live?
There's actually 40 people watching live right now.
It's a world record for ham radio now.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But live. I mean, there'll be lots of people that will see this fact. You know, definitely share it with your club, and we'll share it with other clubs out there, and hopefully they'll learn a lesson out of this.
So 14 of them are our regular viewers, and I'm going to screw up the math now. 14 are our regular viewers, 28 of them are from the W4CQ club, and the rest are from Reddit, but won't admit it.
Yeah, I didn't see a whole lot of Reddit in the chat, but you know.
They're not going to see it. They're not going to admit it.
Yeah.
Okay, I guess that's it. Anybody else any burning, as they used to say at the end of the AA meetings I went to, anybody have any burning desires?
No, man, thanks for having us on.
Yep, okay.
No, thank you guys for sharing your story, and I'm glad this worked out for you.
7-3 friends.
Okay, so down in the we got to do television stuff here. So down in the corner there is Brad O'Dell. Say goodbye, Brad.
Brad's not listening anymore.
Brad is waving goodbye, and then in the other corner,
Brad left the building.
Yeah, and messed up my screen. Ted Williams, not a baseball player.
Thank you, Ted.
Okay. Yep, we're not getting audio from Ted. Anyway, so back at David in David, you got to talk so your picture comes up.
I'm going to say hello.
There we go.
Here I am.
So you're waving goodbye, and I am Gary Pierce, K4AQ.
I'm, sorry.
Oh, okay, go ahead and do it.
I'm David Goldberg, W0DHD.
We almost got to the right point of the music. I really need something to tell me when that music's going to end, so it's so repetitive. I'm Gary Pierce, K4AAQ. I am the high riz. That is, are the kids still saying that? Because if the kids were still saying that, now that I'm saying that they got to stop.
Yeah. So
Gary's using riz. We can't use that anymore. It stands for charisma. And I am the high riz, king of ham.
Thanks for sharing that.
Yeah. Our program has been a repeater pest gets a no contact order. Didn't have room for the words from the judge, but would have liked to. Episode 509. Now you can go watch episode 506.
That's right. After we say
over
and
out. Thank you, Ted. Thank you, Brad.
Thank you, Sean.
Hey, good show, man.
Oh, Sean is still there.
No, that's okay. I have my RF off, my camera off, so I've been listening. You know what the irony of it is? I sent a chat message, but I don't know if you got it. I was probably one of the VEs that signed this guy's CSCE. I'm the trustee of the repeater.
Yeah. You're bi-clubble. There's two big clubs in Charlotte. There's the W4CQ Charlotte Amateur Radio Club, and there's the Mecklenburg Amateur Radio Society, W4BFB, and you're bi-clubal. You're in both.
I'm probably the only person who has ever been president of both of those clubs.
Okay. And you were just hanging out in the Zoom, lurking in the back of the Zoom. I gave you the link. And
yeah, basically, I was working on W4BFB Hamfest tickets and tables and things like that.
Yep.
I'm way behind.
So what did you think of the show?
Good show, man. Good show.
Okay. Are you a regular Ham Radio Now viewer?
Actually, I have to confess, no. I tend to watch the YouTube.
Yeah, that's okay, Sean. Oh, but you do watch it.
What's that?
You do watch it, though.
I do watch it, sure.
Oh, okay. Yeah. All right, well, very few people admit not. To that.
Yeah,
very
maybe not live.
Admit to that.
I just don't necessarily watch them all, you know, every week, you know, in sequence or anything like that.
Yeah.
But, no, very good show, man.
Yeah, but you will be from now on.
Of course.
Still 28 watching. Still 28 people out there.
All right.
All right. Well, thanks, Sean.
Very good.
Sean, tell people your call sign so they know who you are as a ham.
Yes, my call sign is Kilo 4 Romeo Sierra Golf, K4 RSG.
And you are currently not president of the club. You're trustee of the
I'm a trustee.
The W4CQ.
I'm a club trustee right now for the club room and the three call signs that the club owns.
Yeah. Which means whatever goes on the repeater, that's your butt on the line.
Exactly, and that was one of the reasons why I was really pressing for these guys. I'm kind of at a disadvantage right now because my base station antenna is damaged, and I need to raise it up a little bit higher, and I can't always hit the repeater from inside my house. But one of the things I did do a number of years ago is I put this particular repeater is on broadcastify.com, which means that I can listen to it from the internet, no problem. And everything that goes out on that repeater is recorded on broadcastify. So if you have an approximate time and date, you know, you can go back, I think, almost a year and play the recording because they're stored online.
Yeah. If you want to play the recordings, you need an account. Paid account, I think.
You have to have I don't know if it's a paid account, but you have to have an account, I think, on broadcastify.
Yeah.
That's huge. That's huge for you from a protection standpoint, because you can go back and help identify when it's happening. And I love the fact that that the guys out there in the field were recording, I guess, assume on SDRs or other radios, such that they could go back and see on the reverse, he's in this neighborhood, he's in that neighborhood. Because in Los Angeles, you know, our repeater systems are linked. And we run into this every once in a while where we'll get a jam, not a nuisance like this, but a jammer. And it'll take a week or two or three to figure out, okay, he's in this neighborhood, he's in that neighborhood, by doing exactly that, doing the reverse and then kind of tracking him down. And, you know,
So, David, I never asked you during the show, but have you guys fought a miscreant like that to a resolution, or have they just gone away?
You know, usually when you get law enforcement involved, they stop or they go away. The FCC, as noted, the FCC doesn't usually do a lot. They may send a letter or two. Usually when you go figure out who they are and you complain to law enforcement, because we have, you know, that the amateur radio community in Los Angeles area has a lot of ties to law enforcement because we do a lot of, you know, support for sheriff's department, police department, fire. You get the right contact and the right organization and someone there with a, you know, a badge and a gun will go do a door knock and let them know, hey, stop being a bad actor. And sometimes that works and sometimes it doesn't. It's better than, because Brad was brave to go knock on that guy's door because you never know what you're going to encounter when that door opens. There was definitely a guy here that they found him and his, they'll call it a compound out in one of the cities here was big, large area with a big fence and razor wire and said no trespassing and, you know, violators will be shot. And you don't knock on doors like that or gates, you know, you let somebody else handle those kinds of things.
Well, back before I moved to Harrisburg and I had a home in East Charlotte, my neighbor in East Charlotte, I suspected was possibly a drug dealer. He had fortified his front door. He had cameras all around it, and he had I guess what might be described as a vicious dog in his fenced backyard. that there's no proof of any of that, you know, that adds right. up, you know, to him being somebody who's engaged in that type of activity, but I sure didn't want to bother him.
Right. Somebody else's problem, unfortunately.
And I've, you know, most of the people I've tracked down before have been inadvertent QRM people. When I was the president of BSB, I would occasionally go and track down people who inadvertently were jamming our local repeater 146.94. And usually I had a pretty good idea where to go. And I would just take the antenna off the truck and drive around with the radio on reverse. And I actually found two different people that way. And in both situations, I just simply looked them up on QRZ. One of them, I knew the guy well enough that I walked up to his front door and I asked his roommate, was he home? He said, no. I said, would you mind if I come in for a second and look at his radio? He had a conventional, it's a conventional mobile rig, but he had a desktop mic on it that had a lock button. And so it was locked on. And the other gentleman had a mobile rig with a mobile microphone, but what happened, he jammed it into the seat, and it pressed the push-to-talk on it, and he left the radio on.
Yeah. So neither of those guys was malicious. They were just...
Of course not.
...screwed up.
Of course not. That happens here. We had one of the repeaters tied up. Somebody went on vacation, and something fell over on somebody's desk, and the thing got keyed, and he actually went to his house, and somebody said, okay, we found the house. We know who it is. We know which member of the repeater system it is, and they were like, you know, couldn't get in the house, or they're like, just pull the main breaker. And people were like, don't do that, because when he comes home in 2 or 3 weeks, the refrigerator is going to be messed up and the freezer and all sorts of other problems. So they did get a hold of him, and they got in there and undid it. Hey, I gotta drop off, guys. It was a pleasure, and
pleasure to meet you.
I'm gonna say 7-3. Thanks, Gary.
Okay, David, this is fun. We need to tell people about the next two weekends, because we have a Christmas Eve and a New Year's Eve.
Yeah.
Well, and I'm pretty sure we're not going to do a New Year's Eve show.
I think you're right.
You don't celebrate Christmas.
I do not. I'm not 100% sure of what let's talk offline before we get there, and we'll tease a trailer.
Cause I don't think we're not doing anything Christmas Eve.
I will be doing something Christmas Eve, actually.
Okay, well then, never mind.
yeah. Actually, now that I think about it. So we may do it a different day. Yeah. Anyhow, I got to run.
Okay, see you, David. See you, Sean. Great. Thanks a lot.
Take care. Thank you very much, Gary. Appreciate it. Okay. Always nice to talk to a former Chicagoan like I am.
Absolutely. Yep. We're the diaspora. Take care, man. The diaspora.
Have a good evening.
Bye-bye. All right, so we may do a show sometime during the week on a different night. Got some things that are cooking in the hopper. Also it's possible, it's more than possible that we will see you next year. We'll see. But you got shows to watch. 506. Go watch 506. It's a good show. Bye-bye.